To put it into perspective, we have two of just over 400 birds in the entire world sitting behind us. I love the takahē because they're flightless, which is such a unique thing for birds in general, and also how prehistoric they look. They look like dinosaurs running around with feathers.
It's also really special because there are so few of them, and it makes all the health checks we do more important.
I think we've got about three juveniles that we need to do, so they'll be our priority.
Cheers, mate.
Thank you.
Nice. Kia ora, I'm Chris.
And I'm Devon, and we are keepers on the bird team at Auckland Zoo and have the privilege of coming out to places like Motutapu Island and helping Doc manage the northern sites of Takahē.
Which is really important because it means that we can be kaitiaki, not only for the species, but the region and all the other endemic and native species that live there. Since humans have been present in New Zealand, takahē have always appeared in low numbers due to hunting and the introduction of mammalian predators to the point where they were thought to be extinct. But then in 1948, they were rediscovered in the Murchison Mountains, and from there, the population has been intensely monitored, and it's increasing slowly to a point where we have just over 400 birds. On Motutapu specifically, there are 23 birds, which equates to about 5% of the entire population in the world. So it's a pretty cool place to be.
We're going to go and build a takahē pen. Then we'll go around and visit the pens that I've almost finished. And you can decide if you want to start setting it and catching.
Okay, that's cool.
Working at the zoo, we've gained experience with lots of bird handling skills. So on a regular basis, we use those to check the health of our own birds. So it's a nice skill to be able to transition out into the field and use with the populations out here. So over our trip, we want to get hands-on with as many birds as we can. We'll give them a full once-over and make sure they're sensible weights. We'll be taking a few blood samples, and we'll also take fecal samples just to do some further health testing.
We do this every year. Breeding season is once a year, so mainly we're focusing on those chicks that have come into the population and that we can identify them in the future. So banding them and taking bloods to obviously find out what sex they are and what their future in the breeding population will look like.
That's okay. Takahē make their own roost spots every night, and they can do up to 7 meters of poo each a day. So they make a nice mountain there, so it's a good indicator that birds have been spending time nearby.
We've kind of found where this pair has been hanging around near this dam, which is a change of location for them. They've been feeding from hoppers that are in the vicinity as well. And so what we're going to do is set up a bit of a pen with a ramp, so that hopefully they will come in for food, which is when we come in.
So they go up the ramp, jump in, get to the food, and then they remember they can't fly. Too late.
Can't get out, but it's a small enough drop that it's not gonna injure them, just enough that they can't get back out.
I'll get these. You want the bucket? Ready to go?
We'll basically just take along the edge of that gorse and then back up here. Yeah. Sounds good.
All right then.
So we're building the pen at the moment, which basically just consists of some green shade netting, which is to blend in so that the birds aren't too worried about it. Stake it all in, and then the last thing to go in will be a ramp that they will have to climb themselves and drop in the other side. It may not happen in the next couple of days that we're here, so basically we just need to keep coming back and checking.
So these birds are highly food motivated, particularly for their pellet, and they have everything a takahē could need in it. They normally eat grass, but these are like their favourite. They're well conditioned to the sound of the hopper lid. They tend to know that when that's being lifted, it's being filled up with pellet. And then if we start shifting it incrementally, they'll eventually get the gist that the big stash of pellets is in the pen, which is exactly where we want them.
The reason that takahē are able to be on islands like this is because they are predator free. And that's something that New Zealand is hoping to be countrywide. But until that point, they need to remain on islands like this. So everybody should be wanting to eradicate all these mammalian pests so that we can give all the wild places back to our native and endemic species.
Oh, hello. They're right here.
We
see? Oh, I can see one. Just over here, I can't see bands yet to identify it, but just in front of that little faux tree.
We would be coming here to check on the setup and kind of finalise it, bringing it to the ramp here, but they're in the area, so we're going to try our luck.
We might put some pallets on the ramp to kind of make it a little bit more appealing to come up, and then fingers crossed.
So basically we've just caught our two target birds that we were after. So the pen's a bit makeshift, so we're going to get in there before they can escape. That's her.
She's green. So this is the female of our pair. Her name is Flock. And we can tell that by the ID bands on her leg. So every single bird has an individual colour combination of plastic bands, and then they also have a metal band with an ID number that's specific to their individual.
Feet good. Yeah, that's good. Legs are good, and there doesn't seem to be any parasites. She seems real healthy.
Number one done, number two we'll process now. They're gonna come sit here, maybe.
The transmitter.
So it sits just like a backpack does, with shoelaces, and then it has a weak point in the middle. So this block just helps give a good guide for measuring, to make sure they've got enough space to kind of move around and grow, but it's tight enough that they're not gonna get caught on anything. Got it?
Yep.
Now he'll head off and he'll preen his new transmitter into his feathers so it will sit nice and comfortably, and then he'll go find his mate. Oh yeah, nice souvenir. It's beautiful. Yeah. And it's not tuck field work unless you get food on.
It would appear to a lot of people that that is quite stressful to the bird, but the importance of the work that we're doing far outweighs that stress as long as it's kept to a minimum. We always try and find a nice shady area to process. We never keep them in the hand for very long, as short as possible. No wild animal wants to be handled, but they're very forgiving. In a couple of hours they'll be back here ready for food again. So we're in one of the island's more permanent pens, which any animals that were sick or were being transferred off the island would come in here for a bit of chill out time. So we're just going to be checking the containment and basically creating a visual barrier.
So this is all just make it up as you go along type of stuff. When you're out in the field, find what you got and MacGyver it. From a doc perspective, my job is always to make sure that the translocations happen, that they go well, that A, they survive, B, do they get together and have offspring, and is that successful, those mating attempts? Treaty partners are integral to the work that we do. When we do these translocations, transferring birds between sites, and we're doing it for the genetic management of the species so that they don't become inbred on a particular island. Iwi are here to welcome the birds and farewell the birds, and that proper tikanga is observed in this mahi. And to me, that's important to have that moment, the blessing, the thinking about what we're doing, the impact on that bird's life and on the species. Working with the Auckland Zoo staff, Chris and Devon, it's really important to me that I get help when I need it. So this is part of that partnership in action though. They're providing, obviously, their skill base. They come with a lot more captive management skills than me. Having people that I know are used to handling animals, that used to being able to decide when an animal is stressed.
Thank you.
So how did everybody sleep?
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Go to the pen, fix it up.
Come back, get the birds, because their accommodation will be ready.
Exactly.
All right, then. Cool. Let's do that.
Okay. This group tend to be a bit more bold in coming in, so instead of putting a ramp in, we're just hoping to lie in the bushes until they've gotten past the threshold and then basically chase them into the apex.
Oh, someone's coming from that direction now.
Over there.
Obviously, this one's hungry. Unfortunately, it's not actually the target individual we want, so it'll be a bit of a waiting game. So basically, if we have a yellow on each leg, we go for it. So one of us over that side.
Yes.
And then the rest of us will back off.
You can even stay in the ute.
They come from the
ute. Oh, the
you're
ute.
You're used to the ute.
Okay.
So I could drive the ute up to here.
That'll be perfect.
And that way you're in position.
Yeah, so right now we're witnessing the classic Takahē walk 2 meters, go back one. So it never actually makes it around the entire perimeter of the enclosure. So right now we've had a bird come that wasn't the target individual, but is part of the group of the bird that we want to catch. And so there is a transmitter on one of the other birds, not the one we actually want, which we're going to see if they're close by.
Strong. It sounds quite close.
So we've got two that we can see, and I've heard a third contact call from in the bush, which is hopefully the one that we want.
It's just there.
Likes a bit of a run, right?
You're all good. Here.
Yep. So fresh fecal samples at 12:07 for testing, so we'll keep them nice and cold.
So that's another group down. There's probably 4 or 5 to go, but the day is young. So we've just vaccinated another bird ready for transfer off the island in the near future.
Around the outside.
Okay.
So we'll wait
or leave?
We'll just stay back here and give it a
still
try.
Hanging around, it didn't walk off.
So yeah.
Cool. Nice. Just
give him a breather.
It's hard to tell if the first one was in or on the outside of the mesh, but he's in there.
So I've just headed down to check out our capture pen, and we have one of our adult pair in the pen already, and then the other one was just on the ramp looking like he was considering going in when I got there, so I've just backed off and hoping that in the next few minutes he decides to join his mate in there, and then we can jump into action and get our processing done. Hazel's just checked the pen and we've confirmed that both the birds, our target birds, are in the pen, so we'll head down and process. And we are blue, metal, black, red. So it's quite different being in the field, handling birds, capturing birds. We've got quite a controlled environment at the zoo, whereas out here our birds can be in one place one day, somewhere else another day. Our weather changes, we might lack some shelter, but it's making it interesting and making us use our skills the most efficient way.
So I wanted to become a zookeeper in order to try and help the animals that we look after in the zoo, out in the wild. I never thought that I'd be able to do something like this, but it's happened and it's awesome.
Being able to come out to places like this is really motivating, helping out our endangered endemic species and giving them an extra boost to their population. And it's lovely to be able to come back every year and see those numbers getting bigger and bigger. Every time you come visit us in our Takahē at the zoo, you're enabling us to come out here and do our wild work and help these populations out in the wild.